Father, which we have brought. We give thanks for being here, present to one another, for all those who are online. We place before God all that is going on in our lives, in our nation, and in the world, knowing that God shows up where we are at. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be your kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open. All desires are known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of thy Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Grant us,
Lord, to trust in you with all our hearts, for to always resist the proud, who confide in our own strength, so that we never forsake those who make their boast of your mercy. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Please be seated as we break open God's holy word.
Love him. but you have dishonored the poor. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Is it not they who drag you into court? Is it not they who blaspheme the excellent name that was invoked over you? You do well if you really fulfill the royal law according to the scripture. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. But if you show partiality, you commit sin and are convicted by the law as transgressors. For whoever keeps the whole law but fails in one point has become accountable for all of it. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say you have faith but do not have works? Can faith save you? If a brother or sister is naked and lacks daily food, and one of you says to them, go in peace, keep warm, and eat your fill, and yet you do not supply their bodily needs, what is the good of that? So faith by itself, if it has no works, is dead. The word of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Please be seated. Every so once in a while, I get an email or a phone call or a conversation about something that I preached on, or the way I preached on something, or the way in which I engaged the scriptures. And inevitably in that conversation, something was said that was understood to be political. And it's this idea that the Word of God, in its radicalness and its rudeness and welcome neighbor, is somehow never to touch the socio-economic, political reality of the world. I want you to think about what we just heard so wonderfully proclaimed by Janet and by Deacon Virgilia. I want you to think about some of those words, some of those phrases. Is it not the rich who oppress you? Right there from the book of James. You say that in the wrong room and in the wrong situation, people are going to say, what's that about? So I ask you, when you hear that, what is that about for you? What does it mean to fulfill the royal law? Where does that law come from? Where does divine law come from? So often we get used to human law, what it means to be in social contract with one another, about how we live well, and when we don't live well, how do we moderate that? How do we handle that? How do we challenge that? Psalm 146. Put not your trust in rulers, nor in any child here. What does that mean? What does that mean if you're a believer, Christian, who puts all their trust in the ruler? The scriptures are saying something. Put not your trust in rules, for there is no help in them. One of the old prayers in the church, when you gather with your bishop, for whom do we put our trust? We put our trust in the Lord. Let us go to the altar of God. It doesn't mean that we can't have rulers, but it means that there's something about Christianity that holds us to a different type of law, to the divine law, which in our meetings today is again centered around love of neighbor. What does it mean to be a lover of neighbor? Not just your friend, not just the person who's next door to you, but all of those people who we interact with and encounter in the day-to-day reality. Last week, I was talking about how some of our brothers and sisters who are Christian have what I often refer to as a cake batter ingredient list. A plus B plus C equals the cake of salvation. Oftentimes, when I'm out living with my own family, somebody will corner me and talk about whether or not I'm redeemed or saved. And I'm sure you've had this experience too, right? Sometimes with your own family, some of you come out of that tradition, the born-again tradition. And in that tradition, it's very clear what connotates salvation. It's your belief in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, that you are a sinner and without God you have no salvation. But then you get James. And James says something that I think is really important to us. What good is it, my brothers and sisters, if you say that you have faith, but do not have works, can faith save you? There's a large swatch of Christianity, a large swatch in the United States, that believes that it is their faith alone, sola fide, that's their salvation. And yet Scripture says, not so fast. You, we should not be so sure of one's standing in faith and salvation that good works simply don't matter. And I would argue this is why you have Christians doing and saying things that I believe in the eyes of the Lord are an abomination. Good, faithful people who show up every week to church, who are doing and saying and advocating positions that do not really allow us to live into love of neighbor. So what do we make of that? Is there in our scriptures a preferential option for the poor? These texts really speak to that. They say that God takes up residence and makes his tent with the poor. And if we are not taking up residence with the poor, then we are not doing the work of God. If we are not engaging in acts of justice, mercy, compassion, and love with the poor, then we are not loving neighbor as we ourselves are going to love. And therefore, our love of God is called into question, despite faith. A number of you know that I've been spending too much time in Alston, working on a church that was built in 1895, grew rather large, and by 1914, 19 years later, had to build a larger sanctuary. And it's in Alston and Brighton, which is a transitional neighborhood. 74% of that neighborhood is under the age of 24. Just think about that. How many places in the world that the neighborhood is made up almost three quarters by 20-somethings? And this week, one of the big events happens that they call Alston Christmas. And everybody moves around and moves into new digs, and they leave out couches and mirrors and everything from mom and dad's house and grandma and grandpa's house and aunt's and uncle's house. And it can be fun. But there can be really sinister elements to it. I'll give you a couple. A young, some of you may have seen this on television, just two blocks from the church, a young group of kids goes in and rents an apartment, $5,500 a month. Imagine, $5,500 a month. Just translate what you could get down on the Cape for $5,500 a month. It would come with a warranty. This was a basement, $5,500. And the kids walked in, and there was black mold, and holes, and rats, inoperable plumbing, trash, beer can, food in the refrigerator, a collapsing floor, one exit. And they called the city. And immediately the city said, this is uninhabitable. We need to go to a hotel. Now the person who owns that place is a wealthy person using 20-somethings to make their gain and then paying absolutely no attention to the health and safety and care of their tenants. Where does that fall in the scriptures today? I would say that that's one of the reasons why the scriptures say, be careful of those who have power over you, because so often those who do not put the love and the care and the effort and keeping you healthy and safe. It's the reality. $5,500 finds up on 12, and you don't do anything for years and years and years. Finds up by 60 units, and then you begin to wonder what's going on there. Second thing, a young woman came to me terrified. It's in the back of the church. And she said, "Are you the priest there?" And I says, "I'm not the priest there." I says, "I'm helping here, and I am a priest. How can I help you?" And she said, "I'm moving into a new place. I went to go get my security deposit, and my landlord told me I wasn't getting my security deposit back because the floor was dirty. And he seized my $3,000. So 22-year-old, just graduated from a very good university, who's now in a full-on panic because somebody is refusing to give the money back. And she can't move her next step, which is what? First, lost security deposit for a new place. This guy is holding this over her. And worse, he's making the assumption that because she's a young woman, that she'll just move on. So what does a good work look like in that situation? I'm not Superman. You're not superheroes. But we can do super things all the time. So what would a normal set of parents or grandparents say in that situation? Did your landlord put that money into an interest-bearing account for the last 12 months? No. Great. Let's call the attorney again. Three steps, she had a $3,000 check plus interest. And she was able to move on. She was able to move on. This is what it is to put faith into action, to be hearers of God's word. It's to have your ears open for these moments where the powerful and the rich and the haughty are taking those who are vulnerable and doing damage to them. It's not political. It's what it is to be Christian. This is the point of James. James is saying you can have all the faith and sit out there holy as can be, but if you're not looking at the sisters, looking out for each other, then you're not engaging in the word of God. I sometimes think, why was Jesus trying to hide the gospel? And today, he was trying to hide. He was trying to go in that house and not allow anybody to see him, not allow anyone to encounter him. He wanted to go in like Santa Claus, undetected. What's that about? I have lots of answers for that. But I think one of the answers might be simply this. Jesus, the Son of God, the Son of Man, was starting to get worried that his healings, his ability to give people sight, to allow people to hear, to allow people to live, was becoming more important than his teaching of faith. He probably was getting into this place where he said, I'm going to believe in him. And if the only thing that is taken from my ministry is that he was a healer without being a teacher, that he was a preacher without being a person who is allowing you to be converted and transformed, that he was going to be missing the mark. And that mark is very simple. It's really at the preaching every week here. God is love. God sends Jesus as the best form of that love. Why? To to teach us that we are worthy and capable of love. Why? So that we can love others. Why? Because it's in the loving of others and in the passing of that love that transformation happens. From my landlord friends up in Austin, I'm not sure what they're doing. They've been doing it for decades. Now all you gotta do is call 311 and you get a live person, and almost within 15 minutes there's somebody down from inspectional services to interface. So that practice is starting to fall apart. But they're still, as landlords, capable of being safe. They're still, as landlords, capable of treating people differently. They're still, as landlords, capable of getting a just and appropriate price for a house. But what it's going to mean is they have to think. Is this about buying grand houses? Is this about the world and collecting wealth and getting richer and richer and richer and richer? Or is it about being attentive to fairness and equity and justice and appropriately orienting myself to recognizing that I am providing something for somebody and that it can either be transactional or it can be relational? I want to end on this note. On the street in which that church is, St. Luke's Road, there's a landlord who lives in her building. And she's lived there since 1968. And she's got the top floor, and then she's got three bottom units. She was there helping the youngsters move in. She was there giving them cold water as their parents and brothers and siblings lugged all the stuff from the U-Haul into the house. She was there giving her cell phone number to the parents and saying, if anything goes wrong, let me know. She was there at the end of the day buying pizza from T. Anthony's and feeding people. You see that? It's not just transactional, it's relational. And I know that those young people in that house will be well taken care of. I know that they're moving into cleaning facilities. I know that they will be respectful of those facilities. And I know that will be a good experience for them. That's what we're called to do. Be in relationship, avoiding transaction, making sure that when we have power and authority, we use it well, making sure that when we see someone who is off on the side, a young person alone in the city, who is being taken advantage of, that we align ourselves with them. It's simple. It's not political. It's the way of Jesus. It's the way of God. It's the way of this parish church, by the way. From its beginnings, always focused on justice. From its beginnings, always focused on the other. In the here and now, being attentive to one another. Even with masks on, even with the inability to connect as strongly as we usually do at coffee and conversation, just by being in this space, by being online, we have the ability to live into relationship. May we do that well. And when we feel at it, may we pick ourselves up, ask for forgiveness, and move deeper into what it is to be Christ for one another. Amen. Let us pray.
In peace, we pray to you, Lord God. all people in their daily life and work.
For our families, friends, and neighbors, and for those who are alone.
For this community, the nation, and the world.
For all who work for justice, freedom, and peace.
For the just and proper use of our creation.
For the victims of hunger, fear, and injustice, and oppression.
For all who are in danger, sorrow, or any kind of trouble.
For those who minister and stay, the friends, and the needy.
For the peace and unity of the Church of God.
For all who proclaim the gospel, and all who seek the truth.
For Michael, our presiding bishop, Alan and Gail, our bishops, and for all bishops and other ministers.
For all who serve God in the church.
For the special needs and concerns of this congregation. Hear us, Lord.
In your mercy, Lord.
We thank you, Lord, for all the blessings of this life. We will exalt you, O God, our King.
We pray
for all who have died, that they may have a place in your eternal kingdom. Lord, let your loving kindness be upon them.
Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor.
Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you, in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done, and by what we have undone. We have not loved you with all our heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us.
Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let us offer each other a sign of God's peace. You will note the weekly announcements in our bulletin. If you are by chance not getting between the lines twice a month, please check in with Jess. Sometimes people accidentally hit the remove to jump email file or remove from file, and if that happens, it sends a cue to our system not to send to an email. So if you're having some difficulty, you just want to make sure that everyone's getting between the lines. And we also want to make sure that everyone is aware of September 12th, which will happen immediately after our 10 a.m. service. The 10 a.m. service will be here inside, and then we will go outside to celebrate and reconnect. It's 10 o'clock.
10 o'clock.
10 o'clock,
sir.
Everybody's heard it. We are here at 10 a.m., and it is after, immediately following, after the 10 a.m. service inside. We will go outside and be with each other. Should it be raining, it will be September 19th. We will do our best to give you 24 hours notice on that. Let us go to the altar of God.
Restore my love for you.
up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give God thanks and praise.
It is right and good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, thanks to you. God Almighty, creator of heaven and earth, you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing the hymns and proclaim the glory of your holy name. After supper, Jesus took the cup of wine, and when he had given thanks to you, he gave it to his friends and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink of it, do this for the remembrance." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
By grace and sign.
We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, Almighty God, in the sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling Christ's death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these earthly gifts. Sanctify them by the power of the Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son. This holy food and holy drink of new and ending life and death. Sanctify us all so that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and at the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through Jesus Christ, our Savior. By Christ, and with Christ, and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever.
Amen.
As our Savior Jesus Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Hallelujah, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore,
God for the people of God. These are indeed holy gifts for a holy people. Service at 10. So we have an 8 a.m. and a 10. And in place of coffee and conversation, we may be opening up both Christian formation for families, but also an opportunity a couple of times a month to gather together, if you're not a young person, to have community formation, Christian formation with each other. You don't have to come to that, but we're going to do that. And then if we get to a point where things get kind of serious, what we're going to do is we'll shift that time and we'll make that another service. So we'll have an 8 o'clock, a 9 o'clock, and a 10 o'clock, just to give us that spaciousness, right? Really hoping that we can do the 8 and the 10, see how it goes with the programmatic year, have an opportunity for conversation and adult formation, Christian formation, and just try that on, be flexible and nimble, patient. But we're going to do everything possible to be together and remain together. The only thing we haven't quite figured out is Christmas Eve. So Christmas Eve is probably going to be a series of services. We've already started that practice before last year of having our family service, which was a huge success. That allowed our first service of Christmas Eve to not be as crowded. And then we have our later service. So we may have to add another service in there just to keep our spaciousness in place. And of course, we still have a robust group of folks following us on the streaming service, so we will continue to stream the service. If there are any thoughts or reactions, please reach out to the wardens, myself. But I think we'll be returning more towards a normal practice with a rule of action. Another service, the 8 a.m. service, and then let's sort of see how we get into October, November, December. Let's pray for a comfortable fall with 68 to 70 degree temperatures and we can keep everything open. Thank you for everyone who's working on keeping us safe. Let us pray the post-communion prayer together. Almighty and ever-living God, we thank you for feeding us with spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of Christ and heirs of your eternal kingdom, and now send us out to do the work you have given us to do, love and serve you, and the faithful witnesses of Christ our Savior, to him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Even in the post-communion prayer, James is representative that it is for us to go out and to do good work. And now let us ask God's blessing to be able to do that and to do that well. The peace of God, which passeth all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of the Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be upon you and remain with you always and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
everyone.